Good afternoon and welcome to the second meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We have apologies today from Katie Clark, and we are joined by Neil Bibby, MSP, who is attending in Ms Clark's place. We're also joined this afternoon by Maggie Chapman, MSP, Ash Regan, MSP, Tess White, MSP, and Rachel Hamilton, MSP. So before we move on, I wonder if I can ask our MSP colleagues who are joining us for the first time today if they can declare any interest. So I'll just go round the room. Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just to declare, I formerly worked for a rape crisis centre.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Tess White.
Convener, no declared interest.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
I have no interest to declare, but thank you for asking, Convener.
Thank you. Ash Regan.
No relevant interest to declare, Convener.
That's great. And Neil Bibby.
I have no relevant interest to declare.
That's great. Thank you very much indeed. So our first item of business today is consideration of the newly updated policy from the Scottish Prison Service on the management of transgender prisoners in Scotland and the two associated SSIs which are on our agenda today. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2. And we're joined today by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs and Theresa Medhurst, Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service. So welcome both. And we're also joined by two officials from the Scottish Government, Mr David Dorris, Prisons Policy Team Leader with the Scottish Government, and Mr Jamie McQueen, Solicitor with the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. So before we start, I want to make it clear that we are considering the updated policy on transgender prisoners today, as I recognise the public interest in this matter and because several members of the committee indicated that they wish to do so. The committee does not have a formal role as such in approving the new policy. That is not what we are doing today. The purpose of this meeting is to hear more about its content and the rationale for the new policy. So the committee does have a formal role because the policy changes trigger the laying of two SSIs which are on our agenda today. We do have to take a view on whether to recommend to Parliament that these SSIs come into force or should be annulled. So let me begin by inviting Ms Medhurst to make a short opening statement on the new policy and the SSIs, and then I'll ask the Cabinet Secretary if she'd like to add anything further. So, Ms Medhurst.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, Convener and Committee members, and thank you for the opportunity to outline the content of the Scottish Prison Service policy for the management of transgender people in custody, which was published on the 5th of December last year. As you know, safeguarding the health rights and well-being of all people in our establishments, some of whom are the most marginalised and vulnerable in society, is a key priority for the Scottish Prison Service and is at the heart of this new policy. I understand that there have been various submissions to the committee regarding the policy, and I do recognise that the detail of the policy itself not only interests Parliament, but also the wider public in general. The SPS has a proven track record of managing and supporting complex and vulnerable people, and we continue to do this daily on a 24/7 rolling basis with care, compassion and pride. Our commitment to providing person-centred care extends not only to those with clear and obvious additional needs, but to our entire population. As custodians, we manage identified risks bespoke to an individual, which are often not exclusive to transgender people in custody. We are only able to do this with the support of our staff, who continue to demonstrate a long-standing expertise in the management and care of an increasingly complex prison population, which is key to our success. A comment made by one of our stakeholders during the period of consultation is the recognition of one's gender is essential to human rights and individual well-being. This recognition in wider society should, as with all other rights, also apply to prisons. It is therefore essential that our policies reflect and recognise the impact of these wider societal changes. However, I completely understand the need to provide public assurance on how we implement, monitor and review our policies. Our corporate policy review for transgender people in custody has been one of the most comprehensive and evidence-based in recent times. It has been developed following extensive engagement involving over 200 women and men in custody, including transgender individuals, as well as experts in violence against women and a broad range of community organisations and service providers. The policy, by its very design, is applied on an individualised basis. It outlines how transgender people will be first admitted into custody, where they are accommodated during their sentence, and how they will be managed. This personalised approach ensures that any transgender woman with a history of violence against women and girls who presents a risk to women and girls is not placed in the women's estate. Whilst I am clear that this approach supports the welfare of everyone in our care, I am also clear that it provides our staff with the ability to utilise their operational expertise in developing the relationships which are critical to support those we are entrusted to care for. To support our staff, a transition period has been included in the planning to cater for the necessary training which will assist the operational implementation and application of the policy. Implementation, therefore, will commence from the 26th of February this year. In addition, we will also publish at that time our operational policy guidance, our gender diversity guidance, and an evidence review document that will all underpin the published policy that was published last year. Finally, Convener, you will be aware since February last year there has been an unprecedented level of interest in the way that Scotland's prisons manage transgender people. I am acutely aware of the impact, and in some cases detrimental impact, this has had on the health, safety and well-being of people we care for. I therefore welcome this opportunity today to set out the policy in more detail and to increase understanding of this important issue in prisons. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ms Medhurst. Can I bring in the Cabinet Secretary if you'd like to add anything?
I do, and thank you very much, Convener, and good afternoon to everybody that's present here at committee and in the public gallery. The Scottish Prison Service has considerable experience as well as a duty of care for the management of people in their custody, and their policy upholds its responsibilities to deliver safe, secure and suitable services for all. Whilst the management of everyone in custody is an operational matter for SPS, I do welcome the updated policy on transgender people, which has been developed following extensive engagement and careful consideration. The policy makes clear that if a transgender woman with a history of violence against women and girls presenting a risk of harm, they will be admitted and accommodated in the men's estate and not have access to the women's estate. I will speak briefly about each of the SSIs. The Prison and Young Offenders Institution Scotland Amendment Rules 2023 will change the prison rules to make it clearer that prison governors have a discretion to allow a transgender person to be searched by an officer of their birth sex if it is necessary and proportionate to do so. This will ensure that the health, safety and welfare of the transgender individual and staff are considered in searching decisions. This is necessary to ensure that both the current SPS policy and operations on searching and the updated policy are clearly allowed for in the prison rules and that they are easily understood by those affected. This discretion will only be exercised for the purpose of protecting the health, welfare or safety of any person or the security or good order of the prison. For example, if there is a risk to the safety of an officer, if they are to search a transgender individual in line with their affirmed gender, then the transgender individual will be searched by an officer of the same birth sex as the individual. Amendments are also proposed to make clear that governors have a discretion to allow a transgender person to be observed by an officer of their birth sex whilst providing a sample for drug or alcohol if it is necessary and proportionate to do so. Turning now to the Gender Recognition Disclosure of Information Scotland Order 2023, the order proposes to put beyond doubt that it is not an offence for staff involved in the offender management to disclose protected information acquired legitimately in their official capacity when required for the purposes of offender management. It is vital that SPS staff, Justice Social Work Services, the Parole Board for Scotland and others involved in the management, supervision and rehabilitation of those charged with or convicted of offences can, when necessary, disclose protected information, whether a GRC has been applied for or granted, without risk of committing an offence under Section 22(1) of the Gender Recognition Act 2004. The SSIs, if passed, will come into effect on the 26th of February 2024, which aligns with SPS plans for implementation of the updated policy. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So I'm now going to move to questions, and if I may begin with a question for Ms Medhurst. So the new policy says that transfers from the male to female estate will not occur if a prisoner presents, and I quote, an unacceptable risk of harm to those in the women's prison. So I wonder if you can outline a bit more detail around the risk assessment and risk management process in this space, and can you reassure us that the Scottish Prison Service will have access to all the relevant information that it would need from, for example, courts, police, social work and other agencies in order to make in order to inform such a complex risk assessment and management process?
Thank you, Convener. That's a really good question and one that I welcome, because the risk assessment processes that we apply and will apply to complex cases, because this will apply to complex cases, any kind of standard case, so it would be exceptional circumstances that someone would be considered, and under those exceptional circumstances there would be a rigour applied. So the case conference process would go through the risk management team. The risk management teams are multidisciplinary, so we have a range of professional expertise at that table, including forensic psychology. We have criminal justice social work. We have health input as well. So a range of expertise, as well as our own operational expertise. And those case conferences will be chaired by either the Deputy Governor or the Governor within the establishment. They look at the full range of information that is contained within the case file of the individual, including their history, not just their history of offending, but their history prior to coming into custody, their behaviour and response while in custody, and would identify at that point whether or not there were any gaps in that information. In relation to complex cases, sometimes, not always, but sometimes, it's clear that there are gaps, and therefore more in-depth psychological risk assessments can be commissioned, and they would be undertaken by very senior forensic psychologists. Mm-hmm. And those would identify if there are gaps, where those gaps exist, what information we would require in order to ensure that we could develop an appropriate and safe management plan for that individual. And if we can't do so, then that case would progress no further. But where all of that information was tied down, then it would then move to an exceptional case review. And that exceptional case review panel would be chaired by the Deputy Chief Executive. And again, it would include both internal expertise to SPS, but also external expertise mm-hmm. through the Office of the Chief Social Work Advisor at Scottish Government. So a range of professionals at each level who are very well experienced and have expertise in risk management, and well-honed systems and processes that we apply not just to those who are transgender, but across a whole range of other high-risk individuals where that's necessary.
Okay, thank you. And if I may, can I just ask, currently, and I know this is a moving figure, but currently, what is the population of individuals who identify as transgender in the Scottish prison estate at the moment?
The last published data was 23 individuals.
OK, thank you very much. OK, I'm now going to open up questions. If I can ask for brief questions and fairly succinct responses, just we're tight for time. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Russell Findlay.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, panel. Can you confirm that under this new policy, and this is a question for Theresa Medhurst, if the rapist Isla Bryson, or indeed any other male-bodied sex criminal, asked for a transfer to a women's prison, it could happen?
Sorry, I'm a bit confused by your question, Mr. Findlay.
Well, under the new policy, if someone like Isla Bryson or any other male-bodied sex criminal, if you don't want to talk about individuals, sought a transfer to the woman's estate, it could happen.
Somebody who has committed a crime of a sexual nature and who presents a risk to women will not be transferred to the woman's estate.
OK, the presents a risk to women part of it. If it's deemed that someone like Isla Bryson or another male-bodied sex criminal was deemed not to present a risk due to an SPS assessment, they could go to the female estate.
I would be struggling to understand in what circumstances somebody who's been committed of a sex offence would be deemed not a risk to women.
OK, so a male-bodied criminal with a history of violence could, under the new policy, move to the female estate.
History of violence against...
Generally.
Generally. It would depend on the circumstances of that individual case, what that violence was related to, what risks were identified, and it would again have to go through. Anyone who has committed an act of serious violence goes through a very rigorous assessment process, both in relation to their management plan as well as their placement, and that applies regardless of whether or not they are a transgender individual or not.
I understand the new procedure, but I think the short answer to both those scenarios is yes, that they could, in theory.
Highly, highly unlikely, Mr.
Finlay. Okay, thank you. The next question is for the Cabinet Secretary. Now, SPS documents explaining the new policy say that if prison staff misgender an inmate, this could breach the inmate's human rights. And Article 3 is cited in relation to inhumane and degrading treatment. Yet, not so long ago, Hamza Yusuf said that Isla Bryson was at it. Nicola Sturgeon refused to say if she thought Bryson was a man or a woman. So my question is, why should SNP First Ministers be free to speak this very basic truth while SPS staff and female inmates are prohibited from doing so?
Well, of course, everyone is free to speak as they wish, but as you'd expect me to see, Mr. Findlay, and of course, for this to be reflected amongst practice in the SPS, that we endeavour, where appropriate and where circumstances necessitate, to respect people's identities. And if I can perhaps explain my view in this is that given my exposure and involvement and visits to prisons, I know that people wish to live and work in an environment where people are respectful to each other, as that helps to create a more secure and safer environment for everyone, as it helps relationships. And maybe one example I can give, again through my contact with prisoners and ex-prisoners, is that they say that when they are referred to by their name as opposed to by their number, that that small measure, or a measure that may seem small, is very helpful in securing and establishing relationships.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think anyone's got a problem with respecting individuals' names and so on, but this is about the discrepancy between what's required of prisoners and staff being at odds with what has been stated by prominent politicians. Do you see that anomaly?
I understand your question, Mr. Findlay, but I think the reality is that everybody is free to speak as they wish, and I'm not aware of significant consequences for any individual involved in the circumstances that you describe. I think I'm merely stating that, generally speaking, it is better that if people respond and react to each other in a manner that respects people's identities.
Thank you. Theresa Medhurst, the new policies would require female prison officers to conduct intimate searches of male-bodied prisoners who identify as female. Can female staff decline to search male-bodied inmates, or would they be disciplined if they refused?
Staff are not disciplined for any issues that they wish to raise in relation to searching. We have, over a number of years now, had a process in place whereby individuals, are members of staff, are able to discuss their concerns with their manager, and we continue to search transgender individuals in relation to their affirmed gender without much in the way of difficulty. That will continue, and we will continue to work with our staff in the most constructive way possible. Nobody will be... There's no intention to discipline anyone.
So they have an opt-out?
It's not... what I would say to you, Mr Finlay, is that our staff are very professional in relation to the work that they do and how they do it. If there are particular concerns that they have, they are entitled to raise them. We will listen to them, and we will work with them to ensure that...
Do they have an opt-out?
It's an individual approach, and each individual. So, I suppose what I'm trying to say is that we have a responsibility and a duty of care. Where there are individual concerns, we have always worked with our individual members of staff to listen to those concerns and work around that with them. What that results in is how we manage...
OK, I'll labour the point. It sounds like they don't have an opt-out.
Yeah, if I can just come in and move things on, because I do want other members to have an opportunity to come in, and I will come back to you if we have time. John Swinney.
Thank you, Kavira. I'd like to just follow up the point that Russell Finlay's been making with Theresa Medhurst in relation to the discretion that is provided for governors to opt for a search to be undertaken by the original gender of an individual. I wonder if Theresa Medhurst could put on the record the approach that she would envisage that a governor would take in fulfilling the statutory obligation that will be contained within the instruments that the committee is considering this afternoon, in fulfilling that obligation, particularly in the scenario that Mr Finlay puts of where an officer has got concerns about what they are being asked to do.
So the what we have with the new policy, which we didn't have previously, is we have a searching and sampling form, and that form carries out and conducts an assessment as part of the case conference with the transgender individual around both their preference for searching, but also takes account of any concerns around searching. That will all then be recorded and a decision taken as to how the individual will be searched, whether it will be by staff of their affirmed gender or staff of their birth gender. On the basis of that decision, which, as I say, involves both the individual and that risk assessment process, searching will then be progressed. And if a member of staff, if it is in the affirmed gender,
It's difficult to hear, Kavira. It's difficult to hear witnesses when there are conversations going on to my left. I want to concentrate on what Ms Medhurst has got to say to us.
So the governor has a discretion where there is an identified risk of determining whether or not the individual should be searched, the transgender individual, should be searched by somebody from their affirmed or birth gender based on that that assessment. But that assessment does take account and will involve the views and perspectives of the individual themselves. And then on that basis, the searching procedure will be put in place. Where a member of staff to raise concerns about that, then that will be discussed with our line manager and some agreement reached as to how best to move forward in relation to their concerns and how those concerns have been raised. Difficult to say what would happen based on not being sure about whether or not it's concerns from a religious perspective or another perspective.
But thank you for that. But out of that, would you accept that the instrument that the committee is looking at this afternoon places an obligation on the governor to ensure that in their institution that appropriate opportunity for a member of staff to raise their concerns and to have them properly and fully addressed is required of the governor as a consequence of them being allocated this power, this discretionary power?
Yes, I mean, it puts, what this does is it puts on the surface of the rules that explicit decision-making power that they have. They have that at the moment, and we have a way of recording it that we didn't have previously. So it does mean that those decisions are then not only logged, but can be reviewed and... they are recorded, they can be reviewed, and what it also allows us to do is to look at consistency across the estate in relation to how people are being managed, because we can then go in and sample them on the back of that. But it does mean that the Governor will now conduct something which is much more formal than it was previously, and it goes, I think, quite a considerable way to ensuring that we are protecting the safety of everyone, because it takes account of not just the staff's perspective or the individual's, transgender individual's perspective. It brings both of those together.
Okay. So would you say that what is in front of the committee today is a strengthening of the obligation that is on governors to ensure that the perspectives of members of staff, the concerns they have, are being addressed to a greater extent with greater obligation than was the case before?
It's far more explicit, and it will now be recorded as well. So, yes.
Thank you for that. If I could move on then to the ground that the convener started on, which is on the risk assessment that is undertaken. I wonder if you could explain to the committee the degree of rigour and the scope of the risk assessment that is carried out in these circumstances, and also whether that rigour and scope is carried out in many other scenarios within the Scottish Prison Service.
Thank you very much, Mr. Swinney. So the rigour and scope that would be applied for exceptional circumstances, and that's what we're talking about here, would require a very in-depth analysis of the individual's life history, basically. So you're going through everything from their early years and their early life and their life experiences, how they were raised, any issues or matters that arose during that time, their relationships over the period of their early years and into adulthood, and also their response to schooling, any jobs they may have had. And so it takes in the whole context of how someone has lived and has commenced down the road, I suppose, of their offending behaviour, as well as taking account in this particular case of where that individual's transgender journey, I suppose, has started and how that has developed over either a number of years or in more recent times. So it takes account of basically every element of that individual's life and goes into as much depth and rigour as possible, taking account of things like social work reports, police reports, our own intelligence focus. So everything related to that individual in the run-up to and including their time in custody is taken into account.
And where will the... And will the sources of information for that... are there any limitations on the sources of information the Scottish Prison Service pursues to try to ensure that it has the broadest possible perspective on the history of an individual and the potential risk they may pose to any other prisoner or to a member of staff within the Scottish Prison Service? And are there any limitations on the scope of that, the gathering of information that is sought in that respect?
No, we would seek your response as brief as possible. I'm going to have to move things on after Mr. Swinney's final
question. We would seek out all information sources that are available to us. Where there are gaps identified, that's when we would apply more detailed analysis and in-depth scrutiny by our forensic psychology team.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Sharon Dowie, followed by Rona Mackay. Sharon.
Thank you. So the new prison rules don't appear to have any definition of gender in them. So does that mean that for the purposes of prison searches, gender is defined by how a prisoner self-identifies?
So is that something that...
Yeah, well, I think the policy together with the rules means that we are treating gender as the person's affirmed gender.
So how they self-identify?
Yes.
Right, OK. And under the new policy, any male-bodied prisoner who self-identifies as a woman will be treated as a transgender prisoner, even if they change gender while they're in prison?
If somebody... if somebody, whilst they are in custody, comes forward and indicates that they wish to identify either as a transgender man or a transgender woman, then we would take that approach seriously and we would deal with it appropriately.
Can I ask, you said that there's 23 individuals in the prison system just now. How many of them were transgender when they went into the prison system and how many changed when they were in?
I'm afraid I don't have that information.
You don't have that information? No. Right, OK. The Ministry of Justice changed their policy last year. Can I ask why you didn't follow the same policy as the Ministry of Justice?
So we're aware of the changes that the Ministry of Justice made last year. It is not normal for the Scottish Prison Service to follow other jurisdictions. What we do is we, as we did in this case, we review the research, the evidence, we look at other jurisdictions and we take good practice from them. But we apply it to a Scottish context because we are quite different from the MOG. And that's why we have not followed the process down south. There are some practices from HMPPS that we have taken, for example, the searching and sampling arrangements that they have in place. So we will look at taking on practice from other areas. But what we will do is look at our context and our arrangements and apply the policy in the way that we think will best fit the Scottish Prison Service.
OK, so in the Ministry of Justice policy, it had, regardless of conviction, any trans woman with intact male genitalia is also ineligible for allocation to the general population of the female estate. So why did you decide not to follow that part of their policy?
Because the evidence that we've pulled together, the obligations, the legal obligations and regulatory obligations that we have as a prison service, we consider the individualised risk-based approach to be the most effective method of being able to manage individuals and ensure that we can apply due weight to both rights, risks and vulnerabilities to ensure the safety and well-being of everyone. So that's why we've determined the approach of the individualised risk-based approach.
So the SPS has a trauma-informed approach to female offenders. The 2019 model of custody for women recognises women who have suffered some type of physical or emotional trauma are often hyper aware of possible danger, and survivors of trauma may find it difficult to trust others. So how do you reconcile that with looking after the women that are already in the prison if you're putting male-bodied trans women into the female estate?
So the thank you for highlighting the women's strategy and the women's policy, because, as you know, the approach to women in the SPS has been to take that trauma-based approach. And so I'm satisfied that our policy in relation to women is fit for purpose. This policy is actually about transgender individuals in custody, and I'm satisfied that the approach that we're taking takes account of the rights, as I say, the risks, the well-being and safety of all.
But some of the women that are in the prisons are probably the most vulnerable, so, you know, discarding there.
So what I said to the committee when I was here last year, and what the evidence base from our consultation with women in custody supported in the evidence that I provided last year, is that most the women in custody are actually very kind and very understanding of transgender individuals in our care. And what they asked for, and also what transgender individuals asked for, was to ensure that our policy and practice would prevent people who are predatory being given access to the women's estate. And that's what this policy will do.
So I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay, followed by Polly McNeill.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, panel. Listening to your response to my colleague John Swinney and other remarks to Sharon Dowie, I mean, this policy seems to be much more specific and focused on a rich risk-based approach for everyone, not just the 0.3% of transgender prisoners currently have. Can I ask Ms Medhurst, will the policy apply throughout the prison estate in Scotland? And I'm just keen to know how much autonomy governors might have to you know, bend the rules, if you like, and also are they accountable to you if that happens?
So the policy does apply across the estate, and everyone's accountable to me because I'm the accountable officer. But ultimately, what we have concluded from the extensive consultation process that we've undergone and the rigour that we have applied to the new policy is that we do need to have better oversight arrangements in place, and that's why we will sample decisions that are taking place over the course of a year and monitor case reviews to ensure that we're satisfied we've got that consistency across the estate, because that's one of the things that did come through that review.
Sure. And given the low number of transgender prisoners, that should be quite easy to do.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill, followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon. I want to go back to the question that Russell Findlay posed to Theresa Medhurst, which I did find that answer helpful, and I want to make sure that I've understood what you said to the committee. So the policy is where a transgender woman who's had a violent conviction against women or girls and poses a risk. That's a policy. So I think the confusion arises with the phrase "and poses a risk," and this is what I want to examine. Mm-hmm. What I think you said to Russell Findlay is that you could not envisage a situation where the fact of a conviction wouldn't be seen as posing a risk. Would that be right?
Yes.
So that's clear then. So any transgender woman who has committed an offence won't go to the female estate. That's what you've said.
So what I've said is that somebody who is a transgender woman who has committed an offence or has a history of committing offences of violence against women or girls will not be considered for the female estate or the women's estate,
right,
unless there are exceptional circumstances. But those exceptional circumstances would have to be very exceptional.
Right, that's what I'm trying to tease out. So far, because you didn't say that to Russell Findlay, and I think that's what... So these exceptional circumstances, I think I'd like to... So does that mean that the transgender woman who has committed a serious violent offence, so there would be no requirement for this multidisciplinary panel? They wouldn't go before the panel then? There would be no requirement, because effectively you've said there's a more or less a blanket ban on it.
So... If it's considered that the individual should be in the male estate, then an exceptional case wouldn't be required. It would only be where there were circumstances where the vulnerability potentially to the individual may suggest that an exceptional case should be considered. But as I say, I'm struggling to envisage in what circumstances that would happen, particularly in relation to the kind of example okay. that Mr. Findlay referred to, which was somebody who'd been convicted of rape, for example.
So I think in the interest of time, I would find it helpful if you could elaborate a bit further on the where you stick by what you've said is exceptional circumstances, because I think the language is important. So I understand exceptional circumstances would be exceptional. I know we can't always guess what they might be, but if we could provide that information. My further question is, I think this most of parliamentarians in here have taken part in debates about violence against women, and we're agreed that men are the problem. Male violence is the problem. So where a transgender woman has committed a serious violence offence against another man, would that not suggest that they pose a risk to women? So I just wondered why you didn't include that category, if you like.
Does
that make sense?
So I think the range of expertise that can be drawn on, criminal justice, social work, forensic psychology, because what Mr. Findlay did reference was general violence, we would need, as an organisation, to unpick that very carefully, to be very clear and understand what the nature of that violence was, where it stemmed from, and therefore what risks would be posed to women. And that would need to be really, really clear and really explicit before any decision was taken.
OK. I'm right in saying that the Prisoners Officers Association didn't sign off on the policy? Am I right in saying that?
They have remained neutral on it, that's correct.
But they didn't sign off on it. I mean, I've read the minute, that's what it says, they didn't sign off on the policy here. Further to John Swinney's question about, I think this is an important one in relation to the SSI. So I understand the discretion that now that prison governors will have. I just want to try and make that real in my own head. If a female prison officer then does not wish to search a transgender woman prisoner, what is the route then? Can she opt out of that? Does she tell her line manager? I understand the discretion lies with the governor, but I think there's a bit in between I'd like to understand.
So what I was saying, Ms McNeill, was that the individual and their line manager would have a discussion. What I can't say what would be the basis for that refusal. And I have not come across a circumstance where it has been necessary either to compel somebody or to discipline somebody. So it is something which has not hampered the management and the searching of transgender women in custody so far. And I don't envisage it will be going forward.
So a female officer could go to the line manager and say, I'm not happy to search that person.
Then there will be a discussion and there will be follow-up dependent on what the objections from the individual are. And as I say, in over 20 years of having transgender women in the prison estate, there has been nobody disciplined, and I'm not aware of any issue that has resulted in somebody not being searched.
One further question and one question to the Cabinet Secretary. Professor Joe Phoenix from Reading University had written to the SPS as part of the consultation I'm not questioning why you didn't speak to her because we don't have time, but she did say, but she's not the only person to say this, and it's Sharon Dowie had laid down the kind of foundation, which I think you accepted the nature of women's offending and the way we deal with women offenders very well over the years. We're agreed on that. But what she said is the policy is not evidence-based. And she says it does not adequately provide for the safety of female prisoners, as I think you do accept are a vulnerable and marginalised group. Do you agree with that?
No, I don't. No, I'm satisfied and confident, given that I have responsibility for keeping people safe in custody. We have a world-leading women's strategy. We are working towards being a trauma-informed organisation. Mm-hmm. The safeguards, the changes that we are making within that policy, making it far more explicit for staff, the range of factors that they need to consider, the violence against women and girls being at the core of that, the element of unknown risk being considered at the point of admission, as well as the escalation routes and the risk management team involvement being far more explicit, means there are far more protections within this policy for women than there certainly were evident in the last policy.
Just finally,
just intervene? Did you want to ask the Cabinet Secretary about that as well?
Or no, about something else.
Right.
It's just about the... So the Scottish Prison Service have said they're no longer going to give any data on where transgender prisoners are. Now, we can debate whether or not that transgender prisoners can be identified or not. We can also debate that there's been some high-profile cases which get into the press anyway. And it seems a bit unfair to me that in order to do our job, but to scrutinise such a policy, that it's OK for it to be in the Daily Record. And I presume the SPS would still have to answer an FOI request as to where transgender prisoners were. Are you not concerned as the Cabinet Secretary for Justice that this committee cannot do its job if the SPS are no longer willing to give us data as to where transgender prisoners are? I make this point before you answer. I fully recognise the balances that have to be drawn about people's privacy and dignity of transgender people. I'm not attacking that at all. But there have been some very difficult and publicly controversial cases, in Isle of Bryson being one of them, and there are many others. How can we do our job if we don't know if they're in a female estate or not? Or are you just content that the press will just report it, but we as parliamentarians in a democracy cannot know where a transgender prisoner is in the estate? It seems absolutely crazy to me, and I just wondered if you're comfortable with the SPS's decision on this.
So, I mean, I would stress to Ms McNeill, convener, that I wouldn't narrate this as a SPS decision as such. I wouldn't narrate this as a position that anybody is comfortable with necessarily. I mean, sometimes as Cabinet Secretary for Justice, feel the frustration of not being able to talk in a more free and frank manner. But the reality is, as Justice Secretary and as a minister in this government, I have to uphold the law. And if I am getting advice on information governance or advice on data protection, I and, of course, public bodies have to comply with that. I do appreciate some of the frustrations around this. In many circumstances, it would be far easier if it was desirable or appropriate or indeed legal to be discussed.
Can you say which law you're referring to?
Sorry?
What legislation refers?
Data protection. So we have obligations under data protection and we have obligations under
information
governance.
Well, how did it not apply before
governance?
Now then? How has it not applied before now? Because up until now we did get that information, but now we've been told we can't. So what's changed in that period then?
Well,
is a law change or something?
Yeah, well, I'm telling you about the advice that I have received since I've been in office that has come via my officials and the Scottish Prison Service as an executive agency.
Okay, Thank you. Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, Convener, and good afternoon. My question's for yourself, Theresa Medhurst, and it relates to the Scottish Trans briefing that they sent to the committee members, and I'm sure other members as well. Generally supportive of the policy, but they've got one area where they do not feel it will achieve its aims, and that's in relation to non-binary people. So they're actually saying that this will result in some non-binary people being held in either the male or female estate when this is clearly inappropriate to their particular personal circumstances. We are concerned that SPS have not properly understood the range of ways in which non-binary people may transition. What would be your views on what Scottish Trans have said there? That is the only area that they've highlighted.
So point I made right at the start in my opening statement, Mr McGregor, is that we recognise this is a policy purely for transgender individuals, but we recognise that we need to give staff guidance in relation to those who are gender diverse, and therefore there will be separate operational guidance will be published at the same time as the operational guidance for this policy.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Okay, I'm going to bring in Maggie Chapman, and then I'll bring in Ash Regan and Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good afternoon to the panel. Thank you for being here. Just a quick follow-up on Fulton McGregor's question. The guidance that you indicated, will there be an opportunity to scrutinise to have a look at what that guidance is and before it's actually in operation, if that makes sense?
The intention is that we would publish that and operationalise it on the same day as we're operationalising this policy.
But you're taking into account the
absolutely the
issues expressed. Okay, thank you. A couple of other questions. A question around data, and this follows up on the question asked by Rona Mackay. You indicated that you'd take a snapshot sample, to see how decisions have been made and for consistency issues. I'm wondering, given the numbers involved, would it not perhaps be better to actually look at all of the data overall across the whole estate to better understand not only the consistency of application of the policy, but also the impacts on prisoners, trans prisoners and other prisoners, and do that on a regular basis rather than just a snapshot after a year?
So it would be during, it's not going to be just after a year, it's on an ongoing basis.
Right.
Sorry if I misrepresented that, Ms Chapman. So this would happen over the course of each year, but you've made a very valid point that sampling during the course of the year, should we then review all of the samples at the end of the year? I'll take that on board and discuss that with our team. Thank you.
Okay, thanks for that, because I think, and things will change also.
Absolutely.
Over the operation of this plan and as society changes as well. And
yes,
it'll be useful, I think, to have ongoing monitoring and evaluation of this policy. Another question I have is around the searching of prisoners and actually of visitors as well. The policy does refer to the searching of visitors.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wondered if you could say a little bit more about when you would envisage that being necessary and when it might take place, when a search of a visitor might take place by a member of prison staff of a different gender to the visitor.
So that, again, would be undertaken by a risk assessment.
Okay.
So that, I know it's different for visitors because we don't necessarily know them. So if there were any concerns either in the way that an individual's behaving or presents, then that would be the factor that would trigger something or an assessment being made by the staff, the manager, and ultimately by the governor. But this would happen on a very infrequent basis, I would suggest.
And would instances of that happening be recorded?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. My final question, if I may, just for clarity, and this follows on from some earlier questions, if a transgender prisoner is convicted of a crime that has absolutely nothing to do with violence of a sexual or other nature, that what would be the process for that prisoner in terms of the decision of which estate they would be sent to? What would that process be?
So you're talking about on admission?
Yes.
So when somebody comes in, within the first 72 hours, a case conference will be convened. What we would look at is all of the information that's available. If we have all of the information and it is appropriate, if we have all of the information that is no risk, no known risk, and the individual is identifies as transgender woman, then they would be transferred to the female estate. If somebody comes in and we have risks or we have unknown information, so an unknown risk, then we would have to defer a decision until we had fuller information. Very often what you get is somebody will come in with a warrant that says assault. We've no idea what that assault entails, whether it's been perpetrated on a male, a female, etc. So very often it will take time. So although the case conference says 72 hours, it may take much longer before we're able to align and pull together all of the information that we require on which to base a decision. Okay. For accommodation.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful.
Thank you. Ash Regan, followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. Convener, good afternoon to the panel. I'd like to pick up firstly on a response that Ms Medhurst made to a question that was raised by Sharon Dowie, where she made comments around the type that, you know, women prisoners were kind and they were tolerant. I would consider that to be irrelevant, really, in the policy making with regard to women's prisoners' safety. Why does this policy prioritise the feelings of trans-identified males over the safety of women prisoners?
The policy doesn't do that, Ms Regan. I'm sorry. I would disagree. What this policy is for, spoke earlier about the strategy for women, and that strategy for women is based on trauma-informed practice. This is a policy which is about how we introduce and manage and search transgender men and women who come into custody. So as far as I'm concerned, that's what the policy does.
Okay, we'll have to agree to disagree on that, because I have in front of me a number of submissions from experts who've been watching this policy development over the last 5 years very carefully, and they would completely disagree with your position on that. And they say that it doesn't protect the safety of women. And I guess I'm not just referring to physical safety. I'm also, of course, referring to issues like psychological harm, which I'm sure Ms Medhurst will understand where I'm going with that.
Yes, I absolutely understand that, and I accept that entirely. But as I said earlier, this is a policy which is for the management. This is an operational policy for our staff to help them and guide them in the management of transgender men and women who come into custody.
Mm-hmm. So I'd like to move on to the policy underpinnings. And it seems that the principle, or the policy, has been based on the Yogyakarta principles, which states that, which is merely opinion, I would say. So it doesn't have status in international law. It doesn't have any legal standing. So it seems a bit disturbing, wouldn't you say, to be basing policy, prisons policy, an important policy about protecting people, on something like this, and not on things like CEDAW, the Istanbul Convention, the Bangkok rules. I would say this is a serious admission that those international obligations don't seem to be referenced or referred to in the policy. So why is the SPS and the Scottish Government ignoring its international obligations here?
We have, during the course of the whole evidence, research, consultation process, looked at a wide range of rules, regulations, some of which have been referenced in the document, not all of which have been referenced in the document. And it is good practice to look at not necessarily just legislation. In addition to that, things like the Bangkok rules, we are obviously aware of those. We do take cognizance of those, even though it's not referenced in this documentation. I think you'll find it's referenced in the Women's Strategy, but we would always take cognizance of not just legislation and regulatory guidance, but other references as well that are appropriate.
So it's taken 5 years to develop this revised policy, and that was to correct the serious misjudgment in the fact that the previous policy did not consider the impact on women. That's been admitted. So this, the Scottish Government and the SPS have now taken 5 years to make the same mistake again. Because if we're accepting the conversation we've just had, that it is not fully undertaking the impact on women, their safety from psychological trauma and physical trauma, etc., why have we come to this position 5 years later where it seems the Scottish Government is making the same mistake again?
Is that question?
So I'm happy to take that question, Convener, if Ms Regan's content for that. It's vitally important to me, personally, politically, and as a Scottish Government Minister, that this policy in terms of managing risks that some transgender prisoners present, that we view that through the whole lens of all what is now mainstream violence against women and girls policy, so there is a ream of policies, past and present, that have informed the underpinnings of the work that has been undertaken. I am always particularly interested as a minister to understand lived experience, and committee may be interested to know that every female prisoner was surveyed on the policy. A high return rate was received, around 40%, and there was a number of in-depth semi-structured interviews. And what that said to me is that women in custody were less concerned about living amongst transgender prisoners where that was safe to do so. What they were more concerned about, and this really spoke to me, was that we needed to ensure, both as the prison service and executive agency and government, what they were more concerned about is that we get our risk assessment processes right, and that we are alert to people who pose a risk, and that we are rigorous about this, that we do this not in a blanket policy. And there is no blanket policy in the UK, by the way. The policy south of the border has a strong presumption in favour of the measures that it wants to achieve, and also has measures for exceptional cases too. But it is crucial, bearing in mind the learnings of the report that was published last February, where the challenge was put that we needed to rebalance our focus on risk. So I think it is imperative that the focus of this policy that seeks to prevent people who will harm women from ever accessing the women's estate, that we're looking at everybody who comes through the door on a case-by-case basis, and that they are thoroughly and appropriately risk assessed. So that is at the heart of this policy, convener, and it is to make sure that those people who are at risk of harming or who want to harm the women that are in our care, that they are not able to do that. And I should add a point about the expertise of the Scottish Prison Service in this manner, because it's Theresa Medhurst who developed the Women's Strategy and the work to pursue a trauma-informed approach in the women's estate. Trauma-informed approach, by the way, also applies to prison staff as well. And we should recognise the expertise at officer level, but also at senior operational level within the Scottish Prison Service as well, who have been now doing this for I think over 20 years in terms of caring for transgender prisoners and managing the risks where those are presented.
So we wouldn't have
I am going to have to move on, Ms Regan, so I'm going to bring in Rachel Hamilton And then I know Polly McNeill would like to come in, and that will have to be our final question. So,
Thank
Rachel
you,
Hamilton.
Convener. On the risk assessment, Cabinet Secretary, the new transgender policy, prisoner policy states that a risk management team and subsequently an executive panel decide whether a prisoner poses a risk to other female prisoners and therefore eligible to be transferred to a women's prison. Are these the same risk management team and executive panel that decided Isla Bryson should be sent to a women's prison?
So the thing about the new policy, the policy that's just published, is that it retains and builds on the core protections that are in the interim policy. And the purpose of this policy is to strengthen arrangements by ensuring that those risk management teams within prison establishment, those multidisciplinary teams, are well supported. And there is now, as a result of this policy, a very clear and considered approach for where there are exceptional cases. I know it's difficult for us all to hypothesise about those exceptional cases, but every policy, and even the policy south of the border, has to acknowledge we have to expect the unexpected and plan and have a process to deal with cases that have fling up concerns and circumstances that have perhaps not emerged before, or where, you know, risk is very low but vulnerability is high. So any policy should have a process, a very clear and rigorous process around those exceptional cases. But the policy that we now have has a very strong presumption to prevent those who want to harm women, who have a history of harming women, from accessing the women's estate. So we have moved forward.
Okay. Theresa Medhurst, could you answer the same question? Are the same executive panel and risk management team the people that placed Isla Bryson in a women's estate?
So that happened... So, sorry, I can't talk about individual cases. Where we have... strengthen the policy, as the Cabinet Secretary have said, is not just about the escalation process, but that admission process. The admission process is the most vulnerable area that we have, because at the point of admission, we have little or no information on individuals. And that's why we have introduced, as part of this policy, the category of unknown risk. Because very often, as I said earlier, somebody will come in with a warrant and we will have the conviction on it of assault or, you know, attempted murder. We have no idea who's been involved, what the nature of that has been. And that's why that admission process now talks about unknown risk. And very often what we are dealing with the majority of people who we don't know, is unknown risk. So that then ties down a very clear decision-making process, which means that those people who we don't know the risk on will remain in the estate associated with their birth gender.
OK. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to move things on.
Sorry,
we are really tight for time, so I'm sorry. I'm going to bring Pauline McNeill back in for a final question.
It was just Cabinet Secretary. I'm honestly quite confused about what you said to me about the reason that the SPS have announced that they will no longer give us data on transgender, which estate transgender prisoners are in. What is it, GDPR we're talking about? And if it is... Is the legal advice changed? And can you give this to the committee? So, no, they'd like to understand where this is coming from.
So it's based on advice on information governance and advice on data protection. But, I mean, I'm happy to check whether my legal colleague has anything further that would assist us.
OK, if you can. Why all of a sudden, if it's the same GDPR law that hasn't changed, is the legal advice to ministers changed all of a sudden?
Sorry, I think it's just that we've reconsidered the position. I mean, we can follow up in writing as well, if that would be helpful.
So you reconsidered the position. Why?
We're just... the we reconsidered the data protection position in light of this whole policy review, ultimately. But we can...
So again, what's the motive here? What's the motive to reconsider something as important as data around a very publicly controversial policy area?
Well, it was just as part of the general transgender policy review, we were considering all aspects of it. But again, I'm happy to follow up in writing if that would be helpful.
It would be helpful. Sorry, I'm not trying to... Maybe you can understand, just for completeness, from a parliamentarian's point of view, trying to do our job and scrutinising a very important area of public policy, whatever view you take on it, this is going to deprive us of information that we used to have. And it just seems to be on the sort of sword coming down. One day yesterday you get the information, but today you can't. So I'd like to understand
that we follow that point up. It's a valid point, but if I can suggest that that is followed up in writing, just in the spirit of time being against us. We don't have time. We are under a strict time scale for 2:30 and we do still have a formal process to go through. So thank you very much, members, for your questions. And I'd now like to move on to their next agenda item. And we have two negative SSIs on the agenda today that relate to the new transgender prisoner policy that we've just been discussing. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and can I remind all members present that only committee members can participate in this process. So motions to annul have been lodged in the name of Russell Finlay for these two SSIs. So I'm now going to invite the committee to dispose of the motions to annul. So I'll start by inviting Russell Finlay to move motion 6SM11817 in his name and make any brief additional comments that he wishes to make.
Yeah, thank you. I'm sure I speak for many members and members of the public that today's session's been pretty frustrating, kind of falls short of really meaningful scrutiny. It's no criticism of the convener or the clerks and the time that we have available, but this policy ultimately puts the rights of male prisoners who identify as women above the rights of voiceless and vulnerable female inmates. It allows for an acceptable risk of harm to women, and it's a retread of the previous flawed policy. Returning to the SSIs, if I understand the first one correctly, which is number 202364, this allows staff to disclose information about prisoners' trans status in the execution of their duty, and that seems entirely proper. SSI 202366. Now, while the default rule is that a trans-identifying male prisoner would be expected to be searched or could be searched by a female prison officer, this SSI allows for a prisoner of that definition to seek to be searched by someone of their birth sex, and that in itself I don't think is controversial. I think what's much more concerning in relation to the searching issue is, despite repeated attempts, I was unable to elicit from the Scottish Prison Service today an answer as to whether prison officers have an opt-out to search those who are male-bodied in the female estate. On the basis of, I mean, obviously we don't have a vote on the policy in its entirety, which I would obviously vote against for all the reasons we've touched on and many, many more which we've not had time to touch on. But in terms of these two particular SSIs, I don't intend to move them. Thank you.
Okay, that's fine.
So just check everyone is content.
Okay, so on that basis then, can I ask if any other member wishes to object or make any comment? No? Okay, so can I just confirm that you wish to withdraw both of them?
Yes.
Okay, thanks very
agenda
much.
Item three.
Sorry?
Move on to agenda item three.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much indeed. So that completes our deliberation of the SSIs, and we'll now move on to agenda item 3, which should only take a short moment. And if I can just ask members to remain in your seats. So the final question today is whether members are content that the Firefighters Pension Scheme Scotland amendment regulations of 2023 should come into force. And I remind all members that this is not part of our deliberations on transgender prisoners. So can I ask for members if they're agreeant to that? Agreed. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you. So thank you, members. Next week, we will return to the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill with evidence from survivors of sexual crimes with experience of the criminal justice system, and then from victims and survivors organisations. So that concludes our meeting today, and I close this meeting. Thank you.